Welcome to this introduction module in learning and getting introduced into XaTester. So the objective of this module is to introduce you to the XaTester product and the XaTester architecture so you understand how the product works and you can start to do simple things. So the idea is that you should become familiar with the browser client so you can browse around in the XaTester repository, be able to execute simple test cases, and also be able to use the Eclipse client for the same purpose. More advanced concepts and topics will be covered by other learning modules. So the agenda for the introduction is we will start out with a small introduction where we will show you a 2-minute demo of how you can create a test case in a browser. We will also use a couple of minutes on discussing common supported test scenarios that XaTester covers, so you understand its capabilities before starting to learn what it can do. And then we will describe how it actually works, how this first demo that we will show, how it actually works underneath the hood, so you understand what is actually going on. And we will also show you a conceptual architectural diagram, so you understand what part of or what components or parts that makes up XaTester. And then we will move into more concrete topics. First, we will look at the XaTester repository and the different test artifacts that it contains. Then we will examine how you can create and execute test cases from the browser. You will also, by yourself, in an exercise, try to create a simple test case from the browser and also set up a scheduled execution from the browser. And finally, we will also get you introduced to use the Eclipse-based or the IDC or RDC client, where you can create test cases in an Eclipse-based environment. So we will show you directly a concrete demo of how to create a simple test case of a COBOL program called XaRiskCal. So this is a WebAssembly COBOL program. You see the complete source code here in the slide. So this program takes one input parameter, that is the age of a customer, and it calculates a risk factor based on the customer age. So it is WebAssembly, not real world example, but it is really good to illustrate what you can do with XaTester. In the XaTester client, in the web client, I go to the components part of the repository. A component basically defines how a program works. And here I can find my program, XaRiskCal. We have a number of different programs for different environments, like our test environment, system test, and so on. So I take the environment where I want to test my program, click this rocket symbol. It allows me to get to a page where I can enter an input value for the program. It knows the structure of the linkage section. So I can put in an input value. I can set up an expected output value for the risk factor. I know it will calculate 20 when I put in 10. And I can hit an execute button. And then I have to provide my TSO credentials for the mainframe. And I click OK. And now this information is submitted to the mainframe where a job will be started and executed. And we get the result back. So we see I got result back. Everything is green, meaning it is a success. And I can see that I got 20 back where I expected 20. I can do one more thing. As part of a test case, I can also enable code chorus generation. So I click this option button where I can set different options for the test execution. So I enable code chorus, hide these options again, hit execute again. The same thing happens. We initiate a job at the mainframe that will execute the program. It will trigger code chorus collections that we will then collect by XaTester and present for you in the browser. So we see for this test case, because this is a test case, we define our input data and we define our expected output data. And we see we got 78% of code coverage. And we can even see which lines of code has been covered by this test case. So we see we still need 2 more test cases in order to cover 100% of this program. So we need one where age is larger than 18 and one where age is larger than 50. So that was a quick demo of showing you how easy it is to create a test case in XaTester. You might have many questions right now about how this actually works. How can we execute a program from a browser? We will use the next couple of minutes or the next 10 minutes in explaining you how this actually works. But before that, let's use a couple of minutes to discuss common supported test scenarios on the mainframe that XaTester supports. What you saw was the scenario where we are testing a called module in batch. We can also test the same kind of modules in kicks, where we set up input data and verify output data through the linkage section of the program. We can also set up test cases for main batch programs that only operates on files and DB2. So we can set up a test case where you define which input files it should use as input, and you can set up a comparison of the output files with expected output files, and you can also verify content in DB2. Specifically about DB2 programs, when you set up a test case for an updating DB2 program, you can set up the test case to automatically roll back the transaction. And we can still verify data in DB2. So we have a mechanism where we can select data from DB2 before we do the rollback, and in this way you can verify content in DB2. Specifically about kicks programs, we support any kind of kicks programs that are using a combination of com areas, containers, and temporary storage as input-output data. You can also test MQ-based programs. So from a test case, you can both send and receive MQ messages, and we have a way for you to set up the record structure of the MQ message, so it becomes very easy to both set up an MQ message and also to verify each field in a record structure from a received MQ message. You can also test web services with XaTester. That is not the main purpose of XaTester, but if you are using other tools like SOAP UI, a very good open source tool for web services, you don't need to have to use this. You can actually use XaTester for testing web services as well. And it can be quite handy if you're testing Kix services, where you want to test both the web service entrance of the program and also directly the program behind. Some test cases, you might also want to actually not test programs, but test GHL. So you might have a big GHL with multiple steps, and you actually just want to submit a job with that GHL and check that the produced output data sets and DB2 updates are correctly. So you can also create such a test case. Very importantly, you can also stop out submodule calls in a test case so you can achieve higher code coverage percentages. And this is important if you want to, for instance, decide by yourself, now I want to enter this if statement in my code, and this if statement depends on a value from a submodule. Then you can decide that now in this test case, the submodule should return A, and then I know I will go into my if statement. And you can check that by using code coverage, because we also integrate with code coverage engines. So you can check the code coverage data afterwards that you actually went into that if statement. We also have a way to generate a test case when you are having a module that you want to test with many different sets of input and output data. We can generate a test case for you for such a module where you just point out what input fields should be available, what output fields do I want to verify, and then we will generate a Microsoft Excel spreadsheet where you can manage this input data and expected output data. And the test case itself is dynamic, so it will iterate over each row in the Excel spreadsheet. Finally, we also have a possibility to expose a called module as a web-based user interface called Skin, so domain experts can do manual testing. We have a separate module on that and many of the other topics as well. And finally, you can also do test automation. So you can, in a build and deployment process, then you can trigger tests in XaTester, and then you can stop your build and deployment process if the test is not successful. So this is just some common supported scenarios that we do support, so you know that when you're looking at the XaTester material, we can do all these things. And we have modules explaining all of these things in separate learning modules. So in order to understand how XaTester works, how did this first demo actually work, let us first look at what is needed to execute and test a program at the mainframe. First of all, you need to know the name of the program. Then you need to know the input-output data structure for the COBOL program. That would be the linkage section, so you know how to set up data. If it is a main batch program, you would need to know what resources it needs in the JCL, and you need to set that JCL up. And runtime settings we also need to know about. We need to know the load module. XaTester is testing load modules, so we need to know in which load library does it exist in, and if there are required any other load modules for the execution. For DB2 programs, we need DB2 settings, and then we need to know if it is the test environment, the system test, and so on. If it is a KIX program, we need to know the Apple ID, the call type, it is a KIX call or KIX link, and so on. So there are many different runtime parameters. And traditional testing on the mainframe, you would have to write a COBOL program or any program to test any program. You would have to compile it, deploy it to different environments. You might even have to have different programs for different environments. And you would have to handle boilerplate and infrastructure code set up for each test case, manage the programs and data manually, or you would have to create your own test framework and test automation system. And many companies have been doing this for decades. But what you are learning now is that you don't have to do this anymore yourself. XaTester will handle it for you. So with XaTester, it is still the same information we need about a program in order to execute a test case for that program. The difference from traditional testing is we only need this information once. So the first time you want to create a test of a program, you collect all this information and add what we call a component to a shared repository where we have test artifacts in XaTester. And to make this easy for the developers, we have a scanner that can scan the source code or the linkage section of the source and add this structure in the XaTester format to the repository. We have another concept that we call a system where we can group programs together that share the same source and runtime settings. So if you have many programs in the same load library, you can create a system for them so you don't have to re-enter the same information for many programs. So you normalize the data. And the way it would look like when you're adding this component to the repository, you can do it from the browser. You can also do it from Eclipse. Basically, you right-click in Eclipse on the source code, choose XaTester Pass. That will open a wizard that will show you the data structure from the linkage section. You click Next. You select in which environment should this component that we're adding be in, and what system should it use, and that is what runtime settings should it use. And then you click Finish, and it is in the repository. And again, this is also available in the browser, and you can even set up automatic compile scripts that can add this to the repository. And now that it is in the repository, it's the one-time only thing you have to do. Now you can start to create test cases, hundreds or thousands of test cases, without considering anything about runtime. So you use the user interface, Eclipse or the browser, as we saw in the first demo. You locate your components, which represents the program, and say, I want to create a test case. You get a UI where you can enter input data, expected output data. You can execute and see the result directly. So this is a web example of a called program. You can do much more complex things like combining it with SQL select statements to retrieve data. You can compare data sets at the mainframe. You can submit jobs and so on. We will cover all that in later learning modules. This is just the introduction. So let us look at the architecture of how this actually works. So at the mainframe, we have the load module that we want to test. It could also be an IBM i machine, but we have the compiled load module that we want to test. In the middle, we have an XaTester server. This is a decentralized server, Linux or Windows, that keeps the XaTester repository. And then we have the clients. We have the Eclipse client that contacts the XaTester server to look up into the repository to find the program or the component definitions, so it's easy to create the test cases. And the same thing about the browser. And then you can initiate a test execution from the browser, and then the XaTester server that has this XaTester engine will send the information about the program and the data to the program It will send that to the mainframe where we have an XaTester CUS agent. It is a starter task that listens on a port for requests. And this program will generate JGL, submit a job, that will execute the program, and it will collect the data and return back to the browser or to Eclipse. The Eclipse client itself has the same engine, so the Eclipse client will execute directly against the mainframe. Let us look at the repository and the artifacts that are kept in the repository. The lowest level artifact that we have is called a connection, and that defines the physical connection to an LPAR. So it defines the IP address and the port settings and database settings for that LPAR. So there is one default database for one connection that you can also change in a specific test case. And the database is only used when you're using SQL select statements in a test case, not for executing the programs. Then we have an environment, and this is what you normally will use when you set up your test case. A test case is target against an environment. So an environment is using a connection, but then the environment specifies if it is a batch environment or a case environment. And you can set up some default values to be used when you create test cases for this environment. So it contains default values for DB2, and if it is a KIX program, the default KIX Apple ID and KIX channel to be used. Connections and environments can only be created by administrators of XaTester. Then we have the concept of a system. And the system, as we introduced, is just a way to normalize data used by components, that is your programs. So the system contains common source and runtime libraries and settings that can be used by components, so you don't have to re-enter the same data again and again. And the system can also specify one or more environments in which this system can be used. And the system can optionally also specify DHL that should be appended to all component executions. So if there are some shared resources that all of your programs in a specific area uses, you can also normalize that JCL as part of the system. And then we have the component, and the component represents an executable program written in any programming language at the mainframe. So basically it represents a node module. And for the component, you can specify both source libraries and runtime libraries and other runtime settings. And you can optionally also specify DHL that needs to be set up for this component if it is requiring special resources set up by the DHL. And the component can use a system, and then it reuses the source and runtime libraries and settings for the system. And it can also, of course, override these settings if it has special settings. And finally, it also specifies the input-output data structure that it uses when it is called for a Compuware program. That would be the structure from the linkage section. Then we have a concept we call component stops or mockups, and that is saved output data for a specific component. And you can use that for when you set up a test case to stop out submodules, and instead of the submodule is called by the module or component that you are calling, XaTester will intercept the call and return back the data that you have defined in this stop. Then we have test cases in the repository, and a test case is either a simple or a complex test case that can execute one or several components, and the test case will be in the repository, so it is also possible to execute test cases from external systems through a REST-based API. Then we have a concept of test suites, and a test suite is just a collection of test cases that should be executed in one bundle. So when you execute the test suite, all test cases in the suite will be executed. If one test case fails, the test suite will also have failed. Then we have a concept or an artifact we call a schedule, and a schedule is a time-based execution of a test case or a test suite. So you set up the schedule to execute either a test case or a test suite based on a weekly basis or a daily basis. And of course, you don't have to use the XaTester schedule. You can use external systems to set up schedules as well, like Jenkins or RTC or other build systems. Then we have an artifact that is called report. And the report is the result of a test case or test suite execution. So we have a history of all the executions that have been done by test cases or test suites. So you can go in and see the statistics of the tests. We have another artifact called a category, and the category is just to structure your test cases so you have an easy way of finding your artifacts. So it's not just test cases, it's actually all artifacts in the repository that can be categorized, so you have an easy way to finding them. We have another artifact called a job definition, and that is a piece of GHL that you can reuse in different test cases, and the GHL can be used to execute a job from the test case or directly from the browser as well. And then we have a concept called a skin, and the skin is this graphical user interface that you can generate on top of a called module that we mentioned in the common scenarios, so you can save such a skin so it can be reused by other peoples. And we also have a skin for main batch programs where you just define what DD names should point to which datasets and what datasets should be compared after the execution, and then XaTester handle it all for you. One comment about batch, Kix, and IBM i, which are the different platforms that we support. So components in either platform looks the same. The only difference is what environment they relate to and these specific runtime settings that you set up for the component in each environment. When you are creating test cases or executing the component from the browser, as we saw in the demo, or using skins, it looks exactly the same if you are executing a bash program, a Kix program, or an IBM i program. So you don't have to consider that when you set up the test case, because all the runtime settings have been defined on the component in the repository, a one-time only thing you have to do, and then you just concentrate on setting up data. And now that you haven't seen the Eclipse-based client yet, just to mention that a test case can be simple, as you saw in the browser, but it can also be very complex and contains several components executions and several steps in the test case where you can combine many different things, which you will learn in other modules. One restriction is there that all components in one test case must be in the same environment. So you cannot test components in different environments in the same test case. And all of these runtime settings that you set up, for instance, the Kix Apple IDE, the load library, and so on, can be defined on the environment level, on the system level, and the component level. And system overrides values in environment, and component overrides value in systems. And the separate module about setting up components in the repository will go into more details about this. So in the repository, each artifact, for instance components or test cases, will have a table view of the artifacts. And there's server-side sorting, filtering, and pagination of the data, so it makes it really quick to find what you need, because you just start to write the name of what you want to find, and it will automatically be sorted. And when you select an artifact, there's a detailed section where you can see the selected artifact. And here in the repository, you can lock and unlock an artifact. So if you lock it, then others will not be able to use it, unless they unlock it, of course. You will also be able to create versions of your artifacts, and actually the repository can be set up to automatically create a new version every time an artifact is updated. And in general, we also have a read-only mode, so when you browse around, you cannot just change things. You have to actively click an edit button to mark that now I want to change things, then you change your data and click an update. The tables will also contain many columns. Some of them are hidden, some of them are shown. You can change that, you can move and resize columns as you want to in the browser, and it will save that settings for the next time you open it. So to look at how it looks like, here we have the example for the components table. You can show and hide filters in the top right corner. That will show you a category filter, an environment filter, and a system filter. So you can select just, for instance, if you want to just see your development environment artifacts, then it will filter on that. And then you have filters on each column or some of the columns where you can start to write some of the name, for instance, of the label of the component or the program name of the component, and the table will dynamically change itself to show what it finds in the repository. And you can have multiple pages, so you can go through the pages as well. And you can change the column visibility and reset table state from this small icon in the table. And you can also sort on each column by just clicking the column label. It will sort based on that column that you have chosen. And most of the artifacts, you can also add them as favorites. So it will appear on the dashboard that you see when you log into XaTester, and it will also be available in a menu that we'll show later on. And this is what we can see here. There is a shortcut to show favorites and the history that you have done when you're doing the browsing. So you click this show hide button in the top right corner, and that will show this favorite and history view. And you have to click the show hide button again to hide it. And for the lock, unlock, and version support, you can see if an artifact is locked or unlocked on this lock symbol in the table, and you can click on it to lock it and to unlock it. And the same on the details page when you have selected an artifact. And on the details page, there is also a create version button, so you can create a new version, and you can see the history of the versions to the right. And then you can select older versions, and you can restore an older version to be the current version if you want to. And for editing and artifacts, you by default, everything is read-only. So in order to edit an artifact, you have to change to edit mode by clicking the edit button that is available for all artifacts. And then you will be able to see, as you see in the bottom here, you will be able to edit the fields, and you will get an update button or delete button. And sometimes you will get additional buttons. For instance, if it is a test case, you will get a create schedule button that will take you to the schedule part of the repository, so you can easily set up a schedule for a specific test case or test suite. And you can change back to read mode again by clicking this edit button. One slide about how you can execute a component. That was what we did in the demo. So you can select a component in the components list, and then either directly by clicking this rocket icon, or if you go to the details page of the component, there is a go to execute button that will take you to the page that you see here and that we saw in the demo. And here you can fill in input data, expected output data, hit the execute button, and you will see the result. And one thing we didn't see in the demo is when you get the result back, you will be able to actually see what was going on the mainframe. What happened was that when you execute, the CUS agent will generate JSL, submit the job, and return the data back to you. If you want to learn about what happened in this job, you can get the job information directly from the browser by clicking this Get Job Info button. And there is also a show log button you can expand. So in the bottom of this slide, you can see the log that has been written by the XaTester server. That can also be quite handy. And you can actually control in the execution, you can control the log level that you should produce, both for the XaTester server but also for the mainframe. And you choose that in this options area where we also enabled code coverage in the example. We will see that in a later demo. When you click this Get Job Info in the browser, you will see a page that you see the panel that you see here, where you see all the information about your job, including all the steps in the job, and you can even open each spool file by clicking the open button next to the step. And another utility is in the top of the browser, you will be able to enter a dataset name and click enter, and it will open the dataset directly from the mainframe. So if you have an updating program that you are testing from the browser, you can actually look at the datasets that it produces directly from the browser as well. And now for the first exercise, or well, general about the exercises, there should be one environment available for you for the training where you have all the XaTester sample programs. If that is not prepared, someone has to prepare that for you so you can get started on the exercises. And when you are using the components and adding components and so on, you can use a system artifact to normalize these source and runtime parameters. And you can group components together for this. And you will actually select a system in some of the exercises, but right now it is not part of that exercise. And there should also be in the repository, someone before the training should have created an XaTester sample system, so you can see how it looks like and how common parameters has been defined for the XaTester sample programs. And environments and that are in the repository, they are created by administrators, so that will not be something that you can create. But when you are working with XaTester, you will be able to create systems by yourself. And just remember, environments and systems, the concept that we are using, it's not the same concepts as is used in Endeavor, and that sometimes for companies using Endeavor can be a little bit confusing. And now for the first exercise for you, what you should do now is get familiar with the browser. So you should open a web browser. Hopefully you know the IP address of the XaTester server, so you should, and hopefully you also have got a user ID or created for you, so you can log in. If not, then that is something you have to fix first. And then you should log in and get familiar with how to browse artifacts. So you should go to the components page, use text filters, environment filters, try to hide and show columns, resize columns, add some favorites. And then when you have tried that a while, then you should locate the XA Riscal component that we used in the demo. And for the education environment that you are using, select that and look at the data that it has in the repository, just so you get familiar with how to look at a component details. And then you should click the Go to Execute button, fill in an input age, for instance 10, and an expected risk value, for instance 20, click execute and see you get result back. You can also try to get the job info, and then also try to change the value, the expected value, to something that is not valid. Then you will see a verification error. So I will do this exercise now, so you can either look at me doing it first, then do it yourself, or you can skip the next part where I will show the demo and you just do it yourself. First, go to the XaTester IP address of your installation and then enter your Windows user ID and either the password that you decided that you did when you registered yourself, or your Windows password if you have set up the XaTester with Microsoft Active Directory integration. If you don't have any user ID yet, you have to click the create user, create the user and get your administrator to assign you a license. And then you can log in. So I'm logging in. I can see a dashboard of my favorite components. You can see my favorite component, my favorite test cases and test suites and so on. So now you should browse around. Look, for instance, at components. You can open this filter page where you can try to select an environment filter, for example, simu batch, and you see now it only shows the components in this environment, and so on. You can clear the filter. You can also select a system filter, like, and you can start to write. So you, if you start to write, it will filter based on what you're writing. So here I could choose one system, also clear that. And you can choose a category filter. I'm not sure that I have anything in that category, but if you have anything in each of these categories, it would be it would allow you to filter. Yeah, so I had an XaTester demo category, and we see which programs are in this category. And then you can use the filters. For instance, you can search for a program XA Rescal. You can also filter on the name. So just click the name and it will change. And finally, you can change the sizes of the columns. You can move them around. You can click this option to the right, so you can choose which columns to show and which ones not to show. So then you removed the label, you moved the type and so on, and you can reset all states as well. So they got going back. So and you can move between pages here. We see how many items there are in total, so we can move between the pages right here. So this is how you can browse around in the repository, and it is the same thing about other artifacts. And let us also look at a system. So I can take a system here. Here we have a system that we can see it has a label, an ID, main load library, additional load libraries, the same about source libraries. And this is a Kix program. So you can see I can set up the default Kix Apple ID and Kix channel. Well, it's not. It actually, the system doesn't specify which kind of environment. You specify what environments are allowed to use for this system. So the system can define both default batch environment settings and default settings for Kix. So now I should find the XA Rescal application like we did before. So so I find it. You might also have multiples of them depending on how many environments you have set up. So you should use the education environments that you're using for the education. You can first you click on the component itself, so you can look at its data. So you can see the main source library for this XA Rescal is using what we get from the system actually. And we see the runtime parameters, and we see Node.jsl, and we see the data structure in the bottom. And then we can go to the execute page where we can set up our data. So let me try one that will not be correct. 10 as input, 21 as output. I can also click the option button. There are many options. Don't be confused of them. You will learn about each of them in different modules, learning modules. So for now, we just want to look at the log. It will generate log information. We can choose the level. So let us take verbose so we see some more logging, and hit execute. So now it will generate GSL, submit the job, return the data back. We'll see there is a verification error. We see it is red now, and we can scroll down and see that 20 is not equal to 21. And what we can also see now is we can see the log info from the XaTester server, and we see more data is available now. It says where does it execute this, which IP address and so on. It is a batch environment. And we can see everything that is happening in the engine. We can see how it communicates with the CUS agent, the data that it sends, the data about the job info we get back, and so on. So it can be quite useful when things does not do what you think it should do. We can also get the job info by clicking the job info. You can see information about the job, and you can get each spool file by clicking on that, and you will see the spool file info directly here in the browser. And that's it. That was all for the first exercise. So if you haven't tried this out yourself, you should try it out now. Let us look at how test cases are created. So a test case of a component is created by setting up input data to the program and defining expected output data. And this is in general, not just the way that we did it in the browser. So data for a program, input-output data, can either be defined as fields through the call interface. It can be defined as input and output data sets that the program uses, and it can be data in DB2. In the browser, you will only be able to use fields in the call interface. Well, you will also be able to use the skin part of data sets, so you can actually set up the input data set and expected output data set as well. For DB2, you need to use Eclipse. So a test case can be created either from the web client or from Eclipse. So the web client can be used to create simple test cases, as we saw in the demo, and the Eclipse client can be used for both simple and complex test cases, where you can do much more, where you can combine many different things. And test cases in the browser is executed or created from the execution page, where you tried to execute the component yourself. In order to save the data that you have defined for a component as a test case, you click the option button and there is a save input button. Because when you click the save input, it will take the input data that you have provided to the component and the expected output data and save them as a test case in the XaTester repository, so you can execute the test case in a background thread at the server, and you can automate the execution of that tests from external systems. So when you click the save input button, it will show you a dialog where you can choose between private and public input data and test scripts. So these private and public input data, if you choose them, it will be saved as what we call a skin, it is, or input data. That is that you can show the same data as you have in the browser, you can show them at a later point of time. And you can also create a skin, graphical skin on top of that. For this example, you would choose the last point, the test script, where it would generate a test case. And you give it a label and a description, click create new, and it will be created in the test case part of the repository. Test cases can also be created from Eclipse, executed in Eclipse, and then you can upload a test case from Eclipse to the repository, and that is necessary when you want to set up a scheduled execution or when you want to automate test executions from external tools. In the browser, you can show the test case itself as a tree structure, the same way as it looks like in Eclipse, or as code, that is XML code. There's one limitation in Internet Explorer, you will only be able to see it as XML, not as a tree. That requires a Chrome browser for now. Future versions will provide the same possibilities in other browsers as well. And future versions will also provide editing possibilities in the browser. So our goal is to have the same possibilities in the browser as you have in Eclipse. When you execute a test case, in the test case part of the repository, the execution will happen at the server in the background, and the result will be stored as a report in the report part of the repository, where you can find them. And it will also keep an execution history, so you can go back in time and see how often have my tests failed and not succeeded. And you can also see the detailed result. It will actually show the same data as you will see in the Eclipse client when you show it in the browser. So this is how a test case details page looks like in the browser when you select a test case. So you can execute the test case directly from here. You can also maximize the editor so it becomes a full screen. You can show the source code as XML. And we have another feature which is described or learned about in another learning module, where you can execute a test case and you can save the results of the components and SQL select statements, save that for future validation. And if you have done that for a test case and uploaded that to the repository, you will also be able to see the saved validation results in this editor. There's also information about what components are used in this test case. You can see the component name and the IDs of them in the repository. And if you're using stubs or mockups, In the test case, you will also be able to see these in here, so you can see what kind of submodules are we depending on here, or what mockups are we depending on. Looking at reports, if you execute a test case, you will be taken to the reports part of the repository, where you will see an execution history, and you can see the state of each execution. And right after you start an execution, it will be in a running state, because then it will be running in the background thread at the server, and you can refresh the execution history and see when it has completed. When it has been completed, you will be able to see on the details section to the right here, you will be able to see if it is successful or not. And you will also be able to see the detailed results from this button. You can publish the results if anyone has set up publish providers for this execution. You can basically subscribe to a test case so you get emails every time it is being executed. Then it will be published if you click this publish button. That can also be automated, but that is not for this introduction training to go into details with that. So the detailed result will look like this. You will have several tabs with different information: an overview tab, components output tab, compare text tab that can be used when you have a saved validation that you want to compare with, and you can see the source code of the result itself, and also the log from the XaTester server. And now it's your turn to try this out. You should use the web client. You should find the XA RiskCal component that you also did before. Again, you should set up the execution with age is 10, for instance, and 20 as expected. Execute it, see the result is green, so you are happy that it is actually a valid test case. Then you should save it as a test case. And in the test case part of the repository, try to execute it. Then you should create a schedule and finally delete the schedule. And the schedule is created by clicking the edit button and click the create schedule button that will take you to the schedule part of the repository. And now many people might be taking this course, so suddenly many components or many test cases will be created. So a tip is to filter artifacts by your user ID in the modified by column in the test case part of the repository, and then it's easy to find your test case. So I will show you how to do this exercise now, so you can either stop the video now, do it yourself, or you can see me do it and then do it yourself after that. In the web browser, locate your XA RiskCal application, go to the execute page and set up the input value, for instance 10, and the expected value to be for instance 20. Then execute the program to ensure that you get a successful result, so you're satisfied with this test case that everything is as expected. And now this data only exists in the memory of my browser, so of course I need to save this as a test case if I want to use this in the future. So I click the option button, I click save input, I choose test case, and I call it age is 10, education, and I click create new. So now this test case has been defined in the test case part of the repository. So let me go to that, and it is here in the top, and I can minimize this so I can see the selected test case. I can see it has an ID, meaning that this test case is in the repository, so it is possible to execute the test case from external systems. And I can see to the right, I can see the source code of the repository, where I can select the component, where I can also see the input data and the expected output data. And there's also a show source view, and actually that is not really working so well, so you have to select the component again, and then you will see the text or the XML of the test case itself. So there are other options on this test case that you can see, that you can enable code coverage, you can allow execute without credentials. That is a thing to be set up if you want to to execute from external systems and you don't want to provide the TSO credentials there, then you can define the TSO credentials that this test case should execute with when it is not being executed by a user. So if I execute it as a user, I can click on this execute test case button. That will use my TSO credentials to execute, and it will take me to the reports part of the repository, and we see now the execution history of this test case. It is new, so it's the first time there is one, and we can see it is in a running state. So I can refresh, and now we can see it has completed. And it is green, so it is successful, and if I want to, I can click this show detailed result, so I see the detailed result of the test case. And here I can see the tree structure of the test case. I can also go to component output, so I can see what is the result value of the values of the component. I could see the source as well. I could also see the log of the execution. Okay, let me go back to test cases, because what I should do now is to create a scheduled execution of this test case. So I've selected the test case again. I click the edit button. Then I click the create schedule button. It will take me to the schedules part of the repository. And here you can see it refers to the test case ID. And then I have to set up a rule type, weekly, daily, for instance. And I could select a publish provider that it should send emails whenever this executes. And then I could subscribe to this. So I will get an email whenever this test case has been executed. And then I click create new. And now you see this option that I talked about before, allow execute without credentials. I cannot create a scheduled execution without enabling that. Because otherwise the schedule that it is running asynchronously at the server, it would not know what credentials to use. So I have to give permissions to my test case to allow the execution without credentials. So let me go back to do that. So I select the test case, click edit. I click the allow execute without credentials, and then I define my host credentials. And this is strongly encrypted in XaTester, so not it's not easy to get hold of this password. So we click update details, and then I click edit again, create schedule again. I select the rule type, daily for instance. I can select the publish provider again. I already did subscribe to this. I think it will say, yeah, I already did subscribe. And then I say create new. And now we have created a new test case that we see here in the bottom. And there's no need for this schedule to be executed every day, because this is a training module. So you should just delete it by clicking the delete button. Yes, so we deleted the test case again. Or not the test case, we deleted the schedule, and now you are complete with the exercise. So if you not already did this yourself, you should try it out yourself for now. Let us look at how you can create test cases inside Eclipse. So in Eclipse, a test case is just a plain file, and that plain file, you can edit it with any kind of text editor, and you can use the XaTester graphical editor to edit it. The graphical editor has both a graphical view and a textual view, and you can switch between these two views. And you do it from this bottom of the editor. There's these tabs, so there's a source view that will show the XML and the test case view where you can see the test case itself. There's also a repository view in XaTester where you can see all the components and the sub modules stops and the job definitions. You can see them in the repository, the same information that you can see in the web browser. And for the editor itself, there's a palette of different language elements that you can use when you compose your test case. We'll start out by just using the component element that you can use to execute a component. You can execute a sequence of components, which you will try to do. But there are many more elements, for instance, to select data from DB2, to read a dataset, to compare datasets as the mainframe, to submit JSL jobs, and so on. That will all be covered in different modules, other module learning modules in this training series. When in the test case editor, when you select an element in this test sequence to the left, you will see properties for the selected element to the right, where you can change, for instance, the module name. Well, you shouldn't probably do that, because normally you will just drag and drop it from the palette, but you can set up input data and expected output data like you did in the browser. You can set that up for the execution here, and you can set up many other things, especially for the component. And then in the editor itself, there is also an execute button, so you can execute the test case directly from the test case itself. And that will show you a dialog where you can choose log level and so on when you do the execution. And in Eclipse, all of this is available from the XaTester perspective that you can choose in the perspectives chooser. And in XaTester, in Eclipse, there are a number of files used for test cases. As I mentioned, a test case is a plain file in the Project Explorer, so you can keep your files together with the source code of your programs if you have that available in Eclipse as well. And you can versionize these files with any kind of version control system that you might choose. If you're using Subversion or Git, RTC, yeah, whatever that is available for a decentralized file system. And the files that are used in Eclipse, that's the when you're making test cases, the test case itself has an extension called XAUnit, and that is the unit test file that contains the steps or the sequence of steps that you have in your test case. So this file itself does not contain any runtime or environment information, so that is independent of where you want to execute it. So it contains the component metadata definition from the repository, and with component metadata, I mean the structure of the linkage section of the program, or the structure of the input-output data of the program, that is contained in the test case. But the load library information, DB2 information, and so on is not defined as part of the test case. And that means this test case can be reused across different environments. Another file called XACTX is automatically created first time you execute a test case. And this file contains environment and runtime information. So when you execute a test case, you get a dialog where you select the environment in which to test the test case. And that will be saved as this XACTX file called the execution context. And then after you have executed a test case, it will generate a result, and that will be saved in an XARES file, which is the result file containing data about the execution. And this is what you can see when you have executed the test case. There is a result editor that will show you all the relevant information. And a good thing to know is that this result file actually contains the original test case and the original context used for the execution. So if you find an old result file, it will actually show you the context information and the script or test case information as it looked like when it was executed. There is also a log file that contains the execution log that is also written to the console view in Eclipse. So this log file contains all the log statements that is being written by the engine. And the severity of the logs can be chosen when you execute. So that is also kept as part of the context file. The final file, the XAVAL file, it is an optional file that can contain saved execution data used for validating future execution results. And we have another exercise where you will try to set that up. So that was a little bit about files in Eclipse. In Eclipse, in the XaTester repository, you can choose to add test cases in any kind of projects. There is also an XaTester project type that you can create, and the good thing about the XaTester project is that it automatically verifies all test cases for errors when you refresh the project or build files. And for this project, tests are placed under the tests folder, and results will be created in a results folder in the project. And then you can use subfolders to structure your test cases in this project. But as I said, test cases can be saved in any kind of projects. So you don't need to use an XaTester project if you prefer to have them in your own project where you also have your source code of your programs. And now it's up to you to follow the tutorial using the Eclipse client from the XaTester handbook part 1. So please find that and follow the tutorial. It will introduce you to everything of the exercise. Basically, what you will do is you will create a test case with a sequence of 2 module calls where you will use 1 output field from the first module execution as input to the second execution. You will execute the test case. You will use this save results as future validation. You will use that. Then you will try to execute again. See that the validation gives a failure because there's a timestamp involved, so you'll get a validation failure. And then you will open the validation file and make an exception rule. So you exclude that field, you'll execute again and see that you get a successful result. And finally, you will try to upload this test case to the server, so you can go into the web client, find the test case and execute it from within there as well. So either you can start out yourself now and do this, or you can continue to watch the video and I will do this exercise right now. So it's up to you, do it yourself right now or see me do it first and then do it yourself. In Eclipse, first select the XaTester testing perspective. If you haven't opened that already, it is just to click the open perspective, choose the perspective and click open. And now we can start out by creating an XaTester project. You can also skip that and create a test case directly. So you go to the new button here or file new and then choose new XaTester project. And we call it exercise Eclipse. And you can also choose to create an initial test as part of that. So it will create you a new test case called test script, and we can see it is located in this exercise Eclipse project. And now we can start to work on the test case. So the first is to add the XaPGM TST program to the test case. So let me find it in the repository view. I start just to write the name XaPGM TST. And I have many of them because I have many different environments. You might only have one, but then you should select the one that is relevant. You could also create a test case directly from here by right-clicking on it, create test case, but now we already created one. So I'll just take and drag and drop it to the test case. And if I look at the selected and look at the data, I can see, you can see you can resize the editor up here. Mm-hmm. So I can see the data structure. There are different views. So this view, this list view, you can see all fields, no matter where in the structure from the linkage section they are. And you can see the parent hierarchy here. So I like this view because you can see everything. You can also see it already has a value for this iCatch 1, hello. It's actually a default value that you can set up. You can set up default values for each field in the repository. But then you can see there are other fields. I can write, for instance, this char 8. I could write hello. I can write world in the char 16. I can also set up expected values, and now I know it just returns the same data, so I could write world here. And if I look down, this program, it has an XA current time field that will produce a timestamp, and I will use this timestamp as input to the next program that I want to call, because this exercise you should call 2 different components, use this timestamp that this component produces and use that as input to the next program called XA PGM Cal that will calculate number of minutes and seconds until midnight based on a timestamp. So for this component, we see the data in this list view. I could also show it as a tree view, and I could expand all. So you can see the complete structure as it looks like in the linkage section. So here we see the complete structure of this program. And I could even see it in a table view, which is only relevant if it is arrays of data, and a source view where you see it as a plain XML. Yes, so there are other options for a component that you can set up, which we will not work at in this exercise. You can set up submodule mockups or stops. You can set up data sets to be used. You can set up directly the JCL to be used. For now, I will only give this component an ID, so I can call it C1. And this is necessary if I want to refer to the data that this component produces when it is executed. The next thing to do is to find the XaPGM cal program. And I can take that, drag and drop it, and look at the data. And we see for this component, it has this XA current time. So I could enter some timestamp here and it would calculate the minutes and seconds until midnight. But instead of that, I can instead refer to data returned by my first program. And there are different ways of referring to this data. I can use a data reference that will where I can point out the field that I want to refer to. I can also write an expression in here. So let me first try with a data reference. So I'll just take that and drag and drop onto the XA current time. And it sometimes can be hard to hit there. And now this data reference, I need to say what ID do I want to reference? It should be the C1. And here I see the structure of the program. And it was the current time field that I wanted to refer to. And now you can see it produces a path up here to what data that I should insert. And I click OK. And now if we look at the tree structure, I actually dropped it in the wrong place. So it should be dropped on the XA current time. So let me drag and drop it there. And at runtime, this data reference will be replaced with the data that it points to. And that's it. So I can actually execute my test case now. I haven't done any data verifications. That is what I will do later on, except that I did it for the first component. I said that it had one value input world, and the expected value should be world for output. Let us execute the test case so we can see that we indeed can take output fields from one component and use as input fields for another. So I click the execute button. I get a dialog where I can set up different settings, like choose environment, set up the log level, choose code coverage and so on, like we could in the browser, and then I click OK. And now the engine will execute the test case and you can follow on what is going on in the console view. So you can see all the logs that it produces, the engine produces, you can see it directly in the console log. The execution has completed. It opens a result editor where we can see the result of the execution. In the result editor, you see it is opened in a graphical editor that shows the result file that you find as a plain file in the file system. In this editor, you have different views of the data. You have the component outputs view where you can see output of each component. And here we see for the first component, it produces data output values, including the pointer area that is filled out. We also see the XA current time and date has been produced. And for the second execution, we can see that it uses the current time that was produced by the first one as input, and it produces the number of minutes and seconds until midnight. So everything looks correct. We also have an overview tab where you can see if there are any messages. You can see the structure of the test case itself. And there's a verify result that is only used if you have a verify elements in the test case. And finally, you can also see it all as plain text. So let me go back to the test case and show you other ways of referring data. Now we used the data reference element, and you could see that it could be a little difficult sometimes to drag and drop. And we can also use another way of using expressions to reference the same data. And personally, I prefer to use expressions over this data reference element, but I guess it's a personal opinion what you prefer. So in the test case, you can also look at the source code as XML. So in here, you can go and look at the code. And I'll just delete the data reference. So the current time has not been set to anything. I can go back to the test case and expand the selected. And now you see the current time doesn't contain anything underneath. So we can try to use this data reference. So there are two ways. Either you can go, if you select the component, so we look at that, and you go to the current time, the value you can enter, you can either enter a hard-coded value as we have seen, but you can also start to write an expression. And to start to write an expression, you can start with an equal sign, and then you could write equal 3 plus 4, that would be evaluated to 7, but you can also use references to variables early on in the script. And here we see it shows with code completion C1, so I just press enter, click a dot, and it knows the data structure, so of course I need to know where should I find this data, so I can just click my way ahead. And there we are. So that would, at runtime, do the same as using the reference, data reference. And this can also be hard, maybe, to write. Instead, what you can also do is you can go up and expand the first module. You can find the element, right click on that one, and say copy data reference. And then you can go to your component, select the element, and insert into and say paste data reference. And you could also do that if you just click the component and you are in the field of the component. You can right click on that one and say paste data reference. And then you'll see a dialog where you can choose should you paste it in as a JavaScript variable, which is what we did when we wrote it ourselves, or use what is called variable substitution. That is another way to reference a variable where that can also be used in, for instance, JSL snippets. So let us choose a JavaScript variable, so it is inserted. And we can execute this test case and see that we get the same result. And there we go, we got the result. It is still successful because we didn't do any validation of data yet. So we see the first component execution, we see the second one where we use the timestamp with this new way of referencing data using an expression, so we are happy. Last thing in the exercise is that we want to save outputs of these two components and use that as future validation. And that is a feature that is really good to use when you are testing legacy programs that are there and you don't have any tests set up, so you can actually just execute your program, look at the output data, say this is actually what I want to or what I would expect in 2 months from now when I do the test again. So you just click this button up here, save result as future validation, and now it created a new validation file in the file system. So if I go back, execute the program again, it will now compare the new outputs of my components to the saved outputs, and that will produce errors because both programs are using timestamps and they will be different for each execution. So we can see we got four verification errors. We can click on each of them and we can see that it locates where in the structure that there are differences. And we also see this overview tab of the result editor now contains the structure of the actual result and the structure of the saved validation result, and we can see where the differences are. So of course, these timestamps should not be included in the verification. If you want to verify timestamps, you should do that with what we call a verify expression that we haven't looked at yet. But for this comparison, we should exclude these fields, and we can do that by double clicking on the XAVal file. That will open the validation editor, where you can see for each component the structure of the component. So for each component, we can select which fields should be excluded. And for the first XAPGM TST, we should exclude the timestamp and the current date that is produced. And for the XAPGM CAL, we should exclude the same fields as input and also the minutes and seconds until midnight. And let us save this validation file, execute the test case again, and now we should see a successful result. And then even though the result is successful, we might want to see where are the differences between the expected and the actual output, because there are still differences, we just accepted them. And we can see that in the compare text editor in the result. We see the result is green, so everything is fine. And in this compare text editor or compare text tab, we can now go in a textual mode and see where are the differences. And that was all of this test case. The last thing we can do is to upload this test case to the repository so others will be able to execute it. Well, or not others, but it will be able to be executed through external systems. To do that, I will select the context file, right-click on that, choose XaTester, upload to repository. Then I can enter a test case ID if I want to update an existing test case in the repository. Otherwise, I click OK to create a new one, and now it has been uploaded. So now I could go to the browser, find this test case, execute it in the repository as well, and keep the execution history in the repository. That was all for now. So now it's up to you to try this out yourself if you haven't already done it. That completes this introduction module, and hopefully you now should have a quite complete setup both of your browser and of your Eclipse or IDC plugin, so you can access XaTester. And you should also have a good understanding of how you can navigate the repository, have a basic understanding of the different artifacts that are in the repository. You should be able to, through the browser, to execute components and both create simple test cases both in the browser and in Eclipse. And in the browser, you have also tried to set up a scheduled execution of a test case. The next training modules from now on will much focus on the Eclipse part, where you learn to set up test cases for many different kind of scenarios. For instance, how do you test a DB2 program, how do you test a Kix program, how to test a main batch program, and so on. So each module will teach you one specific scenario that you will learn to use in Site Eclipse or in the browser. Thank you for your attention, and see you for the next modules.